Thank you very much for inviting me. My own research is basically has always been how our human mind works. And that's why I entered academia in the first place and studied several fields and found that I did not get that much out of the way in which psychology works today. And also I found that neuroscience for some reason didn't seem to make a lot of progress and was quite uncurious about how our minds work, what consciousness actually is, and how it relates to the processes that implement it. And I also found that psychology is largely a history of ideas, philosophy is largely a history of ideas, and that I could make the most practical progress on this cognitive science project in the context of artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence is, of course, mostly automating data processing. And in current moment, it's mostly machine learning, mostly deep learning, and is very successful. But it always has been a philosophical project as well. And this philosophical project was always a tiny fraction of what happened in practice. But when Minsky and McCarthy and others started the field, they saw themselves in the tradition of a philosophical question. And this philosophical question is, how can we naturalize the mind? That is, how to map it into the world in which we exist? How can we understand how it's implemented in reality? And our own culture seems to have a problem there. And this is often called this hard problem of how to relate mind and reality with each other. And what I find fascinating is that a lot of other cultures don't seem to have that problem in the same way. It's this problem that might have to do specifically with our own metaphysics, with our own way to basically structure the basic reality and how we make sense of it. And because we don't have a metaphysics that allows us to conceptualize our own metaphysics and the metaphysics of other cultures and contexts, we have difficulty to debug that and also to translate contexts between different cultures. And I noticed this one day when somebody tried to explain animism to me, and they said, basically, Japanese mythology believes that everything in the universe is alive and conscious. And I said, this cannot be. I'm pretty sure that Japanese people have noticed that when you hit the person on the head, the person can become unconscious. When you hit harder, the person can even die. And they will not say that everything in the universe is alive and conscious except an unconscious person or a dead person. And so this word means something different from what you make it out to be. You're mistranslating it into your own metaphysics, but the referent is something different. And so we need to look back from first principles in this culture. What are these concepts that are being used to make sense of reality? And so what I find is that psychology is not building systemic theories for methodological reasons, and neuroscience is committed to focusing on the shenanigans of a single cell type only. And the AI is mostly focusing on statistical learning algorithm, and philosophy has lost the plot in some sense in the 1920s. And what is the plot? Basically, it's this naturalization of the mind is the greatest philosophical project. And if we succeed in it by mechanizing the mind, by building a system that works mind-like, it's also the last human philosophical project, because from then on, philosophy will mostly be done by machines that are no longer human, or by systems that are no longer human. And this project was in many ways started by Aristotle. And in earnest, it was pursued by Leibniz, who basically had this insight that we need to mathematize the mind and translate it into some kind of mathematical machine. And this was then taken on by people like Frege, who built a calculus in which he hoped to be able to express thoughts, and Tarski, who made a progress in fixing the issues with logic that Aristotle didn't see yet. And Wittgenstein, who tried to basically to turn English into a programming language so he could do philosophy in a formal language, and failed doing this for the same reasons as Minsky did 30 years later. But Wittgenstein, in some sense, preempted Minsky's logicist program for AI. And I think this led to devastation in philosophy, because most people in philosophy did not think in terms of programming. Wittgenstein already knew that you can represent all logic using NAND gates. And so in some sense, he could already see Turing universality. Turing was his pupil, but he didn't see the need to prove it yet and discuss it. And this is a stream of thought that philosophy hasn't really picked up on. Philosophy mostly didn't understand the significance of the greatest insights of the last century. And I think the biggest philosophical insights of the last century was, first of all, this discovery of Gödel. You cannot build a mathematical machine that is able to run the semantics of classical mathematics without breaking. Right? This was this thing that shocked him very much, that you cannot build stateless mathematics. If you have the stateless nature of mathematics in which you are able to describe infinities and continua, which is a benefit of having stateless mathematics that doesn't work step by step, then you lose a lot of the description of reality that physicists and mathematicians hope to have. And instead, you are forced to use different languages. And the languages that you can use that don't lead into those contradictions that Gödel discovered to be inevitable are computational languages. Your CPU in your computer is never going to be in an illegal state. It's never going to break, right? It's just going to from step to step to step. Just the question is, what does this represent, what this thing is doing? It's a different one than what you might want to express in your logical language. So you can say things in a classical language that cannot be translated into computer code, because they will not lead to a running program. And this means that your semantics are wrong. The semantics of the computer are never wrong, or the semantics of your brain are never wrong. Your brain just goes into that state, and what it represents and so on is just the functional representation of how these the manipulations are happening in the system. The second big insights are related to the nature of computation itself, so the practical ways of performing computations. We've discovered a different ways of formalizing computation, and basically in this way, language itself, because we now realize that all representations are built over automata languages. And then we had information theory and learning, basically how we can express things, how we can build systems that make models of reality, the nature of a model itself, theory of modeling, and the idea of functional approximations. Deep learning, in some sense, has been invented multiple times, and one of the first ones was Alexander Ivanenko, but you know that things are being named after the person who last discovered it. So a lot of things in deep learning are last discovered by people like Geoffrey Hinton and Jan de Kuhn, but there were many, many before them who already discovered them. And I think the other big discovery on the philosophical side is universality, which means all these computational systems have the same power until they run out of resources. And so under the assumption that your computer has unlimited memory and you have unlimited time to wait until it is done, all the computers can do the same stuff. Of course, this is an assumption that is not true in reality. In reality, the systems that you implement have different powers, so they can solve different problems. But very often there is a way to compile between those solutions. But this is a very nice result, because it means it doesn't really matter which computational language you're using to describe reality. You just use the best one for the problem. The power is going to be the same. So this leads us to a position that I would call strong computationalism. And strong computationalism basically is this idea that we can describe representational systems from within using automata, and that every implementable language is, has to rest on automata, and no implementable language can do more than a finite automaton. And this means that hypercomputational objects cannot exist, because you cannot refer to them, you cannot talk about them, you cannot observe them, you cannot conceptualize them. Only things that are computable, in a sense, are things that you can refer to in any kind of language. And so all realizable systems can be described using non-deterministic or stochastic Turing machines. But is this also true for consciousness? Isn't consciousness a big mystery that cannot be conceptualized as such a system? And so when we talk about this question, of course, we have to first agree on what we mean by consciousness. And indexically, when we point at it in a similar way as biologists pointed at living systems before they knew that we're pointing at cells, we can point at consciousness, and what we see is, first of all, this reflexive nature of consciousness. It's not just that there's a content present, but there is the perception that we're perceiving that content. It's a second order perception that is distinctive for consciousness. I suspect there's a particular reason for this, because it's implemented a self-organizing process. And for this process to regulate itself, to stabilize itself, it needs to observe itself observing. Right, so it's basically an observer that is self-stabilizing in our own mind, and to ensure that it's an observer, it needs to test for whether it's observing. And so you see this especially, for instance, when you are exhausted. Imagine you're driving a car, you have difficulty to focus because you're tired, and you remind yourself that you're observing, and you check whether you're still there. And if you don't do this in regular intervals, you're going to space out, fall asleep, and will be not conscious, and will possibly crash your car. Right? And so this is an edge condition where your brain is basically resisting being colonized by your consciousness and being controlled by it, and where you basically have to reinforce it. The other thing is consciousness is always happening now. It creates this bubble of nowness. And this, in this bubble of nowness, you perceive a coherent reality. You cannot perceive incoherent things. Right? Your bubble of reality might shrink or grow depending on how much you can make coherent in your current working memory context. But you can only perceive this coherent bubble. And this seems to be the content of your consciousness. And when you are very calm and when you're in sync with your environment and you can track everything, then this bubble increases. But it's not static, it's not a single moment, it's something like, for me, it usually is about 3 seconds long. This is the moment in which I am. It's dynamic. It's stuff moving. It's basically a region in which I can fit a curve to my sensory data to make a perceptual interpretation. So functionally, I think that consciousness is an operator in mental states. It's the purpose is probably the creation of coherence. That's already somewhat of a hypothesis, not just an observation. So it could be something like a consensus algorithm. If you have ever looked at, for instance, crypto, you know that the blockchain needs to synchronize over all the instances of the blockchain. So there is an algorithm that allows them to reach a state in which no constraints are violated across all the different local representations of the blockchain. And maybe we can think of consciousness as something like a consensus algorithm in working memory, where all the features that are being observed are made compatible with all the other features that are being observed. And it facilitates a spreading organization in the mind, and it acts like the conductor of a mental orchestra. And so if you think of your brain areas roughly as instruments, where every instrument is a function that models one area of the domains of cognition, then they are listening to each other, to their neighbors, and form processing streams. And your consciousness might be seen as one of those instruments. Doesn't have superpowers in the sense that it's able to hear all the instruments at high resolution at the same time. Instead, it's going to focus on disharmonies in this orchestra and then resolves those disharmonies by focusing on the individual instruments and then finding solutions to remove them. And if you don't have, if you're not conscious, you can still perform things, right? If you are a sleepwalker, if you're a somnambulist, you can get up at night and you can maybe walk out of your bed and open the fridge and cook dinner. When you talk to a sleepwalker, there's nobody home. There is no rhyme and reason to what they're doing. Instead, they are just executing routines that they've learned while they're conscious. And this is another observation that we are basically not learning while we are not conscious. So introspectively, consciousness is reflexive decadal order perception that creates a bubble of nowness. Functionally, it's an operator that creates or increases coherence. It's a conductor of our mental orchestra. And we find this is a convergence of different perspectives. So this is very much compatible with Barr's global workspace theory, or Dennett's and Drescher's notion of a Cartesian theater, or Graciano's attention schema, or Metzinger's perspective on how awareness works, or Joshua Bengio's idea of a consciousness prior, a function that basically parameterizes your modeling in such a way to, that you can achieve a low energy state in tracking reality. But if consciousness is not the same thing as intelligence, which I think is the ability to make models, or sentience, which I use as a term to describe the ability of a system to model itself in relationship to the world so it can know what it's doing. Agency, which is the ability to control the future, or having a self, it's a first person model of your own agency. Or empathy, the ability to experience the mental states of others. Sometimes these words are used somewhat interchangeably, but I think it makes sense to keep them apart. And we noticed that different cultures use different terminology to describe physical and psychological reality. And I think the big problem is the hard problem in our own culture is that we don't have that distinction clear. Basically, we are in a scientific tradition, physically monist, which means we do subscribe to physicalism, to this idea that base reality is a causally closed mechanical layer, and everything emerges over that layer. So basically everything in the physical universe is a mechanism, and everything that we look at, interact with, is a mechanism as well. Everything is mechanical in a sense. And the modern version of this mechanism is it's some kind of computation that is implemented somehow in physics. That matter, energy, and space-time are ways to talk about information and how information is moving around between observable locations. Right? On the other hand, we observe experientially that there is a world that we can touch with stuff in space, which you take to be the physical world, and there's another domain, which is thoughts, ideas, emotions, and our own consciousness, that is somehow separate from this. And what we, in our own culture, often fail to acknowledge is that the world that we touch is not the physical world. Right? We don't touch quantum mechanics. What we touch is a representation in our own mind. It's a game engine that is representing our own mind. Both our consciousness and the stuff in space world that we touch are representations existing in the mind that is implemented in physics according to our best theories. So because of this confusion that we have difficulty to relate this to each other and don't realize that consciousness is a representation, that it's virtual, that only exists as if in the patterns of activations in neurons or in the patterns that exist in physics, right? That leads to confusion in our culture. And so consciousness is virtual. It's physical objects cannot be experienced. Right? In the physical universe, you cannot be conscious. Neurons are probably not conscious. But it would be very useful for all these cells in your body to know what it would be like if there existed a person that perceives and cares. And so they create a simulation, and partially a simulacrum of this, of what it would be like if there was a person that cared. And then they use the output of that simulation to drive the behavior of the organism. And you happen to be the content of that simulation. So when you perceive reality as something around you, you don't have access to physical reality. You're in a trance state in which you believe that the stream that your brain is generating about reality is real. So there's still this big question, can we compare digital computers that are our best model of what we can do with representations to what brains are doing? And brains much, much more complicated. And so if you ask yourself how many computers would it take to emulate a brain, and you look at the complexity of a single cell and of your brain, it's very daunting, right? You would need giant amounts of compute to do this. But there's another perspective that people often don't discuss, and it's the question, how many brains would it take to emulate a computer? Because your brain is very noisy, and most of the cells contribute not very much to the computations that are happening in the brain for most of the time. It's similar to people working for a large corporation. If you are an employee of Microsoft, then probably 99% of your cognition doesn't go into Microsoft, but into maintaining your own organism and your immediate relationship to your environment. And similar things are probably true for cells. Right? So the available compute that the individual unit contributes to the global system is relatively small, especially since everything needs to be implemented with error correction in many layers, which requires the system to be highly redundant. And so the thing that shocked me in a way was when the rates for stable diffusion were released, that you have a 2 gigabyte model that contains a visual universe that is much richer than what every one of us has as a visual universe, because it contains every celebrity, every artist, every plant, every historical period and so on is represented. It can be generated as this model. And if this is 80% what of your brain is doing, and it's much richer than what your brain can do, and it's only 2 gigabytes, it's very humbling in a way, because it means that the capacity of our minds is probably a lot smaller than humanity wants us to think. Or we could also say 2 gigabytes is a lot more than most people think it is. Now, if you look at this one, I think it's a very beautiful example of generative AI. Maybe some of you have seen it. And what I find fascinating about this thing, it was basically the result of the prompt of a hungry cat waking its owner, is when you see this for the first time, it looks pretty realistic, right? If you see it for the second time, maybe it does too. And let's look at the left front paw of this cat. Let's check this left front paw. You see it? This cat has two left front paws.
Yeah.
And if you see this video for multiple times, you also see that this hand is disconnected to the body, the face is changing shape and so on. And it's fascinating that on the first like two or three views, you don't notice this. Only after your attention is saturated because you captured the salience of the scene, do you have now capacity to look in all the details and notice the inconsistencies in the scene. And it's very interesting that this thing makes mistakes that a human brain or human mind wouldn't make when it generates such a scene. We would probably not get to the same level of perceptual fidelity, but we would have overall more consistency in the scene. And this inconsistency is because this model is integrating over very short time frames only. So if you only look at adjacent frames, the intonation between adjacent frames is probably fine most of the time. It's just the overall interpretation of the scene over a long enough time span doesn't make sense. And that's why the cat falls apart in this way. And so there is something that is happening in these learning systems that despite using enormous amounts of training data and more compute that is available, I suspect, during our own learning, they don't arrive at models that have the same degree of coherence. It could be that this radical Frestonian perspective that you are just trying to minimize the deviation from prediction in your model is not sufficient. And there's something else that our brain is doing, that it basically focuses on maximizing coherence. And this, in the limit, gets to the same idea as minimizing prediction error. But it leads to models that are more coherent with less data and less compute. So there is a difference between the current AI algorithms and minds. Our AI algorithms use an outside-in design, whereas our minds use an inside-out design. Basically, our mind is organized from the bottom up. The individual cells are sensitive to reward and form an organization across each other. And there's no global control in the whole thing. And all the agency in the system is emergent over the drive of that is contributed by the individual components in the system, similar to an organization that is driven by the people from the bottom up. And there is an attentional agent, basically, that imposes coherence in there. And if we compare this inside out versus outside in perspective, in a technological design, you have a workspace that you know everything, you control everything. And then you use that known reality to extend it by basically building a small corner on your workbench that has additional functionality and now extends your controlled world into that space. And this is how we design technology, with using deterministic structure that we can control from the outside. And when you look at biological systems and social systems, they basically need to live in a chaotic reality where the chaos of the environment is being changed into a structure that can be controlled in a coherent way. So it's in some sense a colonizing principle where you have a seed that is working on an indeterministic environment and changes it into something that it can deal with, that it can administrate. And in a multicellular organism, that also works because you have neighbors that play by the same rules as you do and you can link up with them. So you start out with a seed that is able to copy itself and then finds an organization together with its environment. I'm sure this is something that everyone in this lab has thought deeply about and is aware of, that these principles of organization work differently. And probably are aware of how individual neurons are actually single-celled animals that try to make it work, that are basically locked up together in this dark box. And only if they find the right way to organize themselves can they survive. This perspective of looking at distributed processes to lead to self-organizing computation has always been one of the threats in AI, but it's probably the least visited threat. And in a way, it started with Turing's work on models of reaction diffusion models that he tried to get to compute, and he thought of potentially models of understanding how computation could work in the mind. He didn't get very far. You will probably know the work of Alex Mordvintsev. He also built a reaction diffusion model. This is a model that he made of a reaction diffusion process that leads to the emergence of structure. And the idea of cellular automata has been very powerful in this context. These cellular automata, as they're, for instance, implemented in one-way's famous game of life, are completely discrete systems that will only create stable patterns under very narrow conditions. But it's possible to make these automata continuous and make them more robust to work over a very large range of circumstances. And this idea of neural cell automata is something that's been strongly influenced by this lab and led to work in Blaise Aguirre's team at Google. And Alex Mordvintsev in Zurich implemented some models of this. And I think it's unfortunately stopped relatively early, as nobody has ever used this for actual learning, as far as I know, in an advanced regime. This work is, you can see this on DistroPub and Playbiz, that many of you probably did, is learning bitmaps and recreating them, but it would be very interesting to learn arbitrary functions and to connect them into a fluid architecture. And so you can use those neural cell automata to produce very, very complex dynamic representations of basically arbitrary structure. And so far, we know relatively little about how that works. So there's a hypothesis that I would like to posit to you, and this is when we notice that humans don't learn while they're not conscious, and that we don't get conscious after the PhD, but before we can track a finger. Consciousness might not be the result of extremely complex mental organization, but it's prerequisite. So maybe consciousness emerges first in the mental organization, and then it's basically the primary learning algorithm for a self-organizing system, rather than the other way around, that there are simple mechanisms that are eventually culminate in consciousness. And you find analogies, for instance, in the way in which societies organize. Complexity in a society is not what leads to the emergence of government. It's very much the other way around, that this, some individuals discover the secret of government, which is recursively bullying people. And once you recursively bully people, you basically organize society into some structure that can be controlled. And then you can impose a shared language and a shared reward system and shared goals and impose control and algorithms on that society and get it to scale beyond an individual tribe. And this secret of recursively bullying people has been discovered in many, many cultures independently, right? Because it's some invariance that is not that hard to discover. And once it exists, you have this group of people that refuses to be bullied by others unless they have absolutely no choice, and that they want to reapply this principle over and over and compete with other organizations that have discovered the same idea and have differences in the implementation. And the idea that something like this would happen in the brain is quite interesting. So we observe that humans learn only when they are conscious. If we don't ever become conscious in our life, we remain vegetables. And so if consciousness is more simple than perception, then maybe it's quite ubiquitous in nature. Maybe it is really a relatively simple function. It's not completely trivial. It's not completely intuitive how you get the self-observing observer. But maybe it's the prerequisite for getting more of the complex stuff in your mind. And I have a pet theory that this actually has been known for quite some time. If we look at the book of Genesis in the Bible, which is, I think, mistranslated by the Christians as the creation of a physical universe by a supernatural being, it doesn't make a lot of sense, because the story is much older than the invention of physics by Aristotle. Back then, people lived in a dream world. They know that the world that you experience is a dream, that is somehow has invariances in it and is intersubjective, but it's a representation that can change when your beliefs change and the way in which your perception works change. And so the objects of that dream are being created. And they're not created by some kind of supernatural being, but they are created by your consciousness. And this story is probably more than 3,000 years old, has at some point been introduced in the religious scriptures of the Hebrews. And then being translated into some kind of chant, so you get the six-day structure and so on. But I think it might easily be a six-stage theory of how mental organization works in the mind of an infant. So it starts out with the notion that consciousness is the prerequisite, and it forms before anything else in the mind, before the structure of the world model is created. And then it creates dimensions of difference, and then it separates world model and mental stage, builds a 3D world with the plane of, as the ground, and populates with solid and liquid volumes, creates objects and categories, and makes it invariant against changes in lighting and temporal development. It models agency and creates a personal self. And so if you look at these individual states, basically starts out with this creative spirit, consciousness, hovering over the substrate. And the world is without form and void and tohu bohu. And then it creates a boundary between the world model and the sphere of ideas that in this text are called heaven and earth, or heaven and world. And this sphere of ideas is what Descartes calls res cogitans. this noosphere, this a space in which thoughts and emotions and so on happen. And the other one is the stuff in space, res extensa. That's our world model. It's the game engine that tracks reality. And this boundary is quite fundamental in our own mind. And it's interesting that unlike Western philosophy, we right now recognize that this dualism is not a dualism in the physical universe, in the substrate reality, but it's a dualism inside of our own mind. Right? We have these two types of representation, the stuff in space representation, in which we have a world model that we can touch, and it integrates over our perception, and the space of ideas that is asynchronous to it, where you can hold a thought for as long as you want and imagine something independently of what's currently being perceived. The next thing it does, it is able to create contrast. And we now know it's probably some kind of neural oscillator. The intensity of this contrast is associated with brightness, with the color of the day, and the flatness of the contrast with dark, with the absence of light or data. And now we have that continuous dimension. And using dimensions, you can create arbitrary objects in an embedding space. Right? And the first object that created is space. So the first space that it builds is by combining two dimensions, you get the plane, and the plane gets associated with the ground. And infants start thinking in 2D mostly. So observe this when you see in, during development that infants typically have difficulty to build towers, and not because they can't physically, because they cannot really reason in 3D yet. So initially they really like to arrange stuff on the ground. And then at some point they can conceptualize 3D and the way in which objects are represented in 3D, and at this point, this is sufficient to deal with the entire photonic space in which we are interacting. And then we create liquids and solids, and from them we build objects. And we learn how light changes over the time and objects remain invariant against it. We discover the nature of light sources. And then we create all the plants and all the animals and we give them all their names. And it's all this population of the game engine. It's not the creation of a physical universe. These are not physical entities. These are categories that we form by interacting with the world. And then we also realize that the whole purpose of the exercise is to build a control model for the interaction between an organism and its environment. So we create a model of that organism and its environment and put it into the simulated world. And we find that for the first 2 to 3 years, infants typically refer to themselves in the third person. And I suspect it's not because I is such a complicated word or because they never hear anybody using it, but it's because they don't perceive themselves in the first person. They perceive this person as something that is inside of them. It's a model of that person that is being generated in their mind. And we notice that there's a dramatic change in personality. Once at a certain age, we drop into being mostly in the third person, where we no longer realize that we are creating reality and dreaming it, but we basically experience ourselves as inhabitants of this reality. And we had this weird childhood amnesia, and I suspect it might be related to the fact that once we conceptualize ourselves in the first person, we re-index our memories. And when you have children, you will notice this thing that they have perfectly fine memories during their first year of life and second year of life, and they can remember in their second year of life what they did in their first year of life. But somehow, after their third year of life, they forgot everything that was before. It's pretty weird, and it's interesting invariance in most children. And I think that's basically we associate our personal self, this conscious first-person perspective. And once I stumbled on reading Genesis in this way, it made total sense, and I could not unsee it anymore, because this original interpretation that after God creates the world, creates humans in God's own image, it don't really look like anything that hovers over the face of the waters and makes light and darkness, right? And it creates it as man and woman. And I think what happens is that this outer mind creates another spirit, another consciousness, that is another model of being, that is put inside of this world and thinks of itself as man and woman, that thinks of itself as a human being, that experiences itself as a person. That is, I think, expressed in here. And I think it makes total sense to put this text first to explain our own nature to us and our own way of experiencing reality and relating to it. So consciousness is creating a self-perpetuating intelligent recurrent information transformer, abbreviated spirit. I suspect that spirit is basically the word that, that our ancestors used to describe self-organizing software agents. And self-organizing software is relatively ubiquitous in societies and organisms. It's basically the operating system that controls our organism as a software agent that runs on our body and controls its functions. And the hierarchies of software agents the individual cells also run software that is controlling the cell, right? Down to the molecular level, there are individual molecules that move around because the software of the cell wants it to. And it's a very interesting perspective when we think about organisms, that the true invariance is not the shape of the organism or the individual molecules that are contributing to it, or even the individual mechanisms that are being implemented. The invariance is the software, right? It's the set of principles that are being implemented by the mechanisms. So if you want to understand this notion, the basic central is self-organization, that structure is being built from the inside out, it's self-reinforcing and energy optimizing, that it's software. Software in its nature is not physical, it is virtual. It exists as if, as a pattern in physics. But it's an invariant pattern that is able to enforce and replicate itself. And it is, in a sense, it's not a thing. Ontologically, software is not an object, it's a physical law. It's when you say, I have a word processor running on my laptop, what you say is, whenever I take a bunch of transistors and put them in this and this state, the following thing is going to be observed wherever you are in the universe, right? And this invariance is what we call software. Software is just a very, very specific physical law. And the same thing is true for the software that runs on our cells, right? It's basically a law-like structure that says when you arrange matter in this and this way, then you force-grain it in a particular way, so you look at it from a certain perspective with a certain resolution, then you're going to observe the following succession of events. And that's an invariance. And this invariance is what we call software. And when we talk about the word agent, what we simply mean is a control system for future states. So unlike a thermostat, it only controls the present. An agent is a control system that is able to model the future to some degree and is optimizing for future states instead for present states. And once we introduce this condition that the control system is optimizing the future, we have the simplest definition of agent that I could come up with so far. Because all the features like beliefs, desires, intentions fall out of system that models the future and tries to optimize some future state. Because now you have decision making, you have intentions and beliefs in the system in some sense, in functional sense. So what we notice is the consciousness could be the principle that organizes information processing in brains, could be the same principles or similar principles that work across other cells as well when the organism organizes itself in its information processing. What we notice is that all cells can send conditional messages to neighboring cells, right? Not only neurons can do this. And so why is it that only brains are able to think and perform operations that allow brains to model reality and interact with it? Maybe other cells can do that too, right? Is this a revolutionary idea? For most cultures, it's not. For neuroscience, it is, because neuroscience knows only neurons can compute for some reason. I don't know why. All the other cells that are adjacent to the neurons do not really contribute very much. On the other hand, we notice that even the ones of C. elegans don't run in simulations. So basically, there is no model in neuroscience that is complex enough to actually replicate learning and control as it happens in nervous systems if you put this into a simulator. They're able to get abstract features of neurons right and so on. And we see a lot of interesting things when we look at the connectome, but we cannot actually model the brain of Drosophila or portion of it in an adequate way, where we actually have the neurons as the switching units. And this could be because our models are incomplete, but it could also be because we are missing something. Maybe neurons are basically just telegraph cells. I suspect that neurons have evolved for a very particular purpose, to move our muscles very fast. And to do this, we basically needed to build wires into our organisms that translate information very, very quickly. And they have a high metabolic cost. And they need to speak a specific code so that it's stable over long distances. They basically speak in Morse code to each other in these spike trains. And these spike trains have different constraints than the cellular communication to neighbors. If you just want to talk to your neighbors, there are many ways of doing this. You can elicit them mechanical signals just by pushing at the membrane of another cell. You can exchange all sorts of chemicals. You even can send over RNA to send very complicated messages. But the spread of these signals is going to be limited by the jumping from cell to cell. And this means that signal propagation is going to be like millimeters or centimeters per second at best. This means it's magnitude slower than what the nervous system can do. And so once you evolve telegraph cells to move your muscles very fast, to compete with other animals at a high metabolic cost. You also need to do perception and decision making at the same rate. So you build an information processing system out of telegraph cells. And this telegraph network is able to make sense of reality and control the organism very quickly. but this doesn't mean that the other cells do not have opinions as well, right? So it's quite conceivable that if you are a multicellular organism that lives for long enough, that it makes a model of reality that allows this organism to discover itself in the world and solve problems in the same way as a nervous system would do. It's just going to be a couple magnitudes slower than our nervous systems operate. But this is a hypothesis that most of our science is very uncurious about, which is weird when you think about it, right? It makes sense that plants have operating systems similar to animals that run on them, but they would not need to use specific cell types. So you don't need to look for nerves in plants. You also, for information transmission in our organism, it's not always necessary. It's dedicated cell types which do this, because any kind of cell type can be recruited in sending information across the organism. So if information, a consciousness can organize information processing in brains, it's conceivable that there is something that is analogous to our consciousness that exists in plants, just over different time spans. And our ancestors actually believed that very strongly. So if you look at the European fairy tales, they basically say that the spirits of plants are sentient and they populate the forest. And one day in fairyland is 7 years in human land, which might allude to this time differential. But what we see is that plants have means for functional approximation. They can learn. There's evidence for communication inside of plants. So if you harm the roots of a tree, information gets sent to the leaves and back to the roots, and the tree reorganizes accordingly. And there's also evidence for communication across plants, even over considerable distances. So when you have a forest in which one side gets infected by some bug that invades the forest, trees long far away are going to develop defensive measures long before this happens. So there is some kind of communication going on across the forest. There's another aspect. If you are living next to a tree, and if you're, for instance, a mushroom, you can probably learn to send information to the tree, because the individual cells in the tree don't know what information they're translating. They're just passing on a certain pattern. And if there's another organism growing next to it, then there are no firewalls. It means they need to evolve to get along. And this probably means that forests over a long enough time spans are going to evolve something like an internet. And this internet is going to have some kind of shared protocol over which the individual software agents that run on the plants can build feedback loops that extend beyond an individual plant, which allows them to be somewhat non-local in the forest and even move around in some sense in the focus of attention. Right? This is something that I don't know whether that's all true. It's something that a lot of cultures look at. And I, as a computer scientist that looks at this from an evolutionary perspective, I just look at means and motive, and I don't see how to stop evolution from forming such a structure. So it would be something that I would be inclined to look for and be very curious about, because I suspect it should evolve under normal circumstances. It's something that we should expect to exist in nature, because it is very useful to the plants and to the ecosystems. And it also has a lot of explanatory power, and evolution can totally result in this. So this question, do plants have spirits, do forests have internets, and can these spirits travel to forest internets, is very, very interesting from an evolutionary perspective. And so it could be that there is a complex ecosystem of spirits in nature. And these thoughts basically has led me to adopting animism as a useful metaphysical perspective, not as some kind of religious superstition, but as a perspective that basically says that we want to understand living nature. What's central is self-organizing software. It's not just mechanisms, but it's the software that is stabilizing those mechanisms and is recreating itself through those mechanisms. So if life is animated by self-organizing software, the invariance is not a matter of the mechanisms, but the software itself. And this gives us a slightly different perspective of evolution. For Darwin, evolution is the competition between organisms. And then Dawkins comes along and says, no, no, the organisms are just a phenotype. What actually matters are the genes, right? So actually evolution is about these complicated molecules that replicate themselves by expanding themselves into phenotypes and then evolving. But from this, cyber animist perspective, I would say that evolution is the competition between software agents that partially encode themselves in the genome and implement themselves into the organisms. But the actual invariance that you're observing is the software. Right? And that is very interesting, because this is actually this Japanese metaphysics. that describes that living stuff is basically software that is colonizing regions of the physical universe. And when the software breaks down, then this region of the universe is up for grabs for other spirits that try to move in and control that region. It's a very interesting perspective that I found is basically healing a lot of the rifts that we have in our metaphysics. So from the perspective of artificial intelligence, the question is, can we switch out the outside-in design that we currently have in AI that leads to the production of mechanical systems that basically like a golem are following a set of instructions to a way in which we can organize the substrates in ways that are compatible with life? So basically, can we take this new substrate that works at a fraction of the speed of light much better than these cell the substrates that we currently have to run minds and organization on? And can we populate them with consciousness and with the principles of life? Can we basically extend our organization of living things into the new substrates rather than building machines that are competing with life and replacing it? And I think that's a very interesting perspective. I think we should put some effort into studying the principles of self-organizing software and see if you can get them to run in silico. And this is basically what I want to leave you with for today. Mike had to run because he has to give another talk. And but I think we have a few minutes left for computation. Sorry, for disputation and for discussion and questions and ideas and remarks, doubts.
You'll have to excuse it because my voice is kind of gone. But you know, one of the things that I look at is I tend to look at things as like a generalized language structure.
Mm-hmm.
Cognition is very much that way, whether it's plants, other animals, humans, microorganisms, whatever. And I'm wondering, what are the ways that we know that we can actually directly communicate with other organisms? So for example, if you wanted to actually communicate with a plant or communicate with a dog, how do you actually get on that same type of metric? Because, for example, you would think that if these other organisms, lesser organisms of complexity, have a less complicated language, like a dog or a cat, yet we don't really understand it, right? And we don't really think in that way. So what is the kind of that bridge between allowing us to communicate very directly, like we're communicating with you right now, with other organisms and, you know, things in the ecosystem?
We're not communicating directly right now. We are communicating
yeah.
by natural language.
Yes.
And this natural language is basically a solution to breaking down your mental representations, which are a language by themselves,
yes.
into a discrete string of symbols in a learnable protocol. And to parse this discrete string of symbols, sequence of symbols that we're using, that's why we can write it down as a string, we also are, have some limitations, like we have a stack depth of about 4 or so, because otherwise language would not be learnable for everyone. So we have a few constraints on language that makes it learnable and comprehensible to us. To basically, language is not something that you can touch
yeah.
or point it. It hangs in the thin air between speakers. They need to be able to agree on it. And that's why it needs to be reduced in complexity to make it learnable. But the language in our own mind is different. For instance, it is not entirely sequential, but to some degree, it's parallelizable. You can basically envision a scene in which multiple things happen at the same time. And it's also executable. You can, unlike natural language, which you cannot really run in your mind, which you can use to instantiate something that you can run, there is a language of thought that produces structures that you can actually execute, like plans or even software programs that you can instantiate in your mind and run. And these are interesting features of our language of thought. And I suspect it's a good idea to, at some point, not regularize the LLMs to produce strings of natural language as their working memory content, but to produce something that is an invariant structure with limited complexity, highly regularized, that is basically below the tokens that we currently parse. So we go a few layers in and then try to regularize the structure there into some operator semantics that we discover and that is able to construct and navigate the embedding spaces of our LLMs. And so when we are talking to a cat, for instance, or if you are talking to a baby, we are basically trying to figure out what state is this other system in and how can we interact with it. And that can also happen on a perceptual level. And notice that my daughter is extremely good at communicating with animals. And that's because she feels what the animals are feeling. She vibes with them, right? She interacts with them on a very low level, on a level that is preconceptual. And this allows her to build a feedback loop because the animal is also capable of doing that. And as a result, she is able to communicate with the cat much quicker than somebody who is only trying to make inferences on a symbolic level about the state of that cat. And it's also a way in which many of us communicate with each other. It's just, if you are a good scientist, you probably have a bit of autism. And that makes it harder for you to communicate non-symbolically.
But I would also say that ability to kind of disassociate from the situation and see it under a new light is also responsible for a lot of the ways that we kind of create breakthroughs or new discoveries, because I like to say you're kind of looking at the same stimuli differently,
mm-hmm.
right? You're looking at a different angle of the same thing because there's some level of ambiguity, degrees of freedom of interpretation.
Yes.
Now take your point a step further. What are we all doing right now? You're speaking up here. You're not physically touching us in any way, yet we're directing our bodies and minds towards you. So it's almost like when you have a language or some means of communication, getting on the same vibe as somebody else, is you're controlling each other across different aspects in time and space. That's why it's easy for us to control other humans, to a degree control other, you know, other animals. How can we get tell a chair to move itself? Does it have the self-modeling capacity to move itself over here? No. So what I was thinking is how do you, in a perfect world, if you had enough agents around, like chairs or tables or whatever, that had some type of self-modeling capability in many ways that could be accomplished, you could cognitively, like we're talking to each other right now, if I were to yell, you know, F-I-R-E really loudly, or, you know, other things in a room full of students in a school, we'd all react a certain way to that. Having not physically touched you at all, if there was a tiger walking into the room right now, without interacting with us in any capacity, we'd be scared like nuts, right? So I think there's this kind of really interesting idea between the degrees of freedom some type of stimulus has and how you're interpreting that and reacting to it, right? So that's basically conditioning. So the end of that rant and my question for you is, what are the ways that we can improve that, those degrees of freedom in an agent and our ability to interpret that? So maybe you could say that's intelligence or consciousness or something to do with working memory in terms of capacity. Like, how would you kind of go about that?
When you think about the degrees of freedom, there's this paradox of free will, that is, the less you know what you're doing, the more degrees of freedom you seem to have.
Correct.
And the more you know what you're doing, the fewer degrees of freedom you have, right? Because you know what your actual options and what the outcomes are and how you're interfacing with reality. And so you compensate this to some degree by expanding the degree of control that you exert on your environment, by basically being able to model reality more deeply. And then are controlling a larger part of reality and identifying yourself as a system that has much greater influence on the world. And so this boundary that we have is not the boundary of our skin to the environment. It's the boundary over which we can build feedback loops into the world that we are interacting with. And what's an interesting observation is that basically all agents above a certain complexity are collective agents. They're built from lots of units that an individual agency excels and or behaviors in your own mind, and that they need to harmonize themselves into some kind of collective agent that keeps itself stable and harmonized, coherent over all the individual sub-agents and produce a globally coherent behavior. And we as a species, we are a state-building species, not just a tribal species. We are, in some sense, infinitely scalable. And this is because we are able to form population-level agents and civilizations that we become part of. And individually, we are not generally intelligent. Individually, we cannot discover a natural language. Individually, we cannot develop writing by ourselves from scratch. Individually, we don't discover the concept of Turing computability or universality. What we discover is step by step over many generations. Before we get to the notion of what a language actually is, you need 1,000 years of an unbroken intellectual tradition.
I have a question regarding consciousness and learning, and how subconscious or subconsciousness fits into your model. Do you only need to have a consciousness to learn? Is it possible to learn something subconsciously?
When you are not attending at all, you have difficulty to learn. When you are able to attend to the thing that is happening, you can often learn quite complicated things in one shot. It could be that your attention is spread out, and there are a lot of things in your attention, and most of them are not made a protocol over, but they still register in some way and integrate it in your working memory context. In this sense, you can learn things via repetition that you don't attend to very much, to the degree that you can find a lot of information about in the protocols, what you're attending to. There's another question that is more interesting, that is, our emotion and motivation is computed outside of our personal reflexive mind. Right? The personal reflexive model of ourselves is embedded into our larger mental environment. And what you feel about the world is not generated by you, it's generated by your outer mind. It's also not generated about the universe. When you experience pain or laugh or something like this, it's not done by your personal self, and it's also not done by the universe through the surface of your body. It's happening inside of your mind by systems that are intelligent, right? They need to be able to understand your actual interests in the world. And so you're being presented by ideas from your outer mind, by some agent that models how you should be embedded in the world. And that thing is outside of your personal individual consciousness. But what you often find when you meditate is you can integrate this part, and you can interact with it and notice that in some sense it is you. It's usually something that is just separate. It's not integrated with your personal self. And you can deconstruct the boundary. So it's basically as if there are two protocols being maintained in your mind. And as a result, these parts of you don't know about each other.
What happens when you're able to fully integrate that part with yourself?
It depends. So for instance, there are meditation schools that teach you jhanas, which are states of bliss that you can induce at will. And it's, in some sense, it's if you are stumbling into the room where your brain makes the cookies. And you can then decide to ward yourself on cookies. And this might lead to bad effects. Right? If you are a child, you think that the reason why you don't have enough cookies is a resource constraint. But if you're an adult, you realize cookies are a tool to make you eat your vegetables. And if you eat too many cookies, you're going to get diabetes. And so when you eat your vegetables without cookies, that's actually even better. And so it depends on how well you understand the interests that you have in the world. And normally your mind is set up in such a way that you don't get right access to parts of your mind that would break your performance. But as we get older, we get ideally more control about how we operate, and we learn how to control our emotions and make them appropriate to the situation that we're in. And in many situations, we stop having emotions, because an emotion is an involuntary reaction to something. And very often, it's not necessary to react involuntarily to something. We can voluntarily react to something when we know what it's good for.
Yeah, when you were talking about the emergence of the first-person perspective, and I guess I see that related to self-awareness. How would that be related to not remembering when you're earlier in your life, like ages 1 to 2? That was an interesting idea, but I didn't quite fully understand that.
You notice this when you start meditating and overcome this separation between personal self and world generation. A lot of people drop into the state unprepared, and then they feel, oh my God, I'm the universe now. I'm a cosmic spirit. I'm now one with cosmic consciousness. And instead, what they are is they're one with this generator function that produces the model of the universe in their own mind, right? And then you notice that your personal self is a representation inside of that, and you are no longer identified with it. And so when this happened to me the first time, it was very confusing. I basically noticed I'm no longer Joscha Bach. I know everything about that guy. And he is a person, and I run on this person's brain, but this is just a model of what that person is. And I'm basically this thing that perceives things that are happening right now and can influence and is dreaming what's currently happening. And in some sense, that's a more truthful perspective. So basically our mind introduces the separation artificially because it's useful for running the organism. And if you basically wake up too early and realize that this person is not real but virtual, and you are creating it, it might be difficult for you to function in the world in which you have this control problem to solve. Right? And once you basically build a stable game engine that is tracking reality very well, it's no longer necessary that you attend to how you construct the reality around you and the people around you and the models around them. And instead, you need to optimize on the interaction between the person and the environment. And that's why you only look from the perspective of the person. But I suspect that this is not happening from the beginning. So infants do not conceptualize themselves as a person yet. They don't see themselves as humans yet. There are more basic organisms that are dreaming a reality and without having the concepts of describing what they're doing. And at some point they create this person, and then at some point later in your life you deconstruct it again.
Might it be that the memories exist from when you were born or you're one, but it's too confusing for your brain now to interpret that? Or
so this person which
that
exists inside of you does not remember that it created the game engine. Because it didn't, right? It was another locus of control that did this. This locus of control is only taking care of the interests of the organism. It doesn't need to remember that once in the mind there was a process that created the structure of your mind. And so it is not a relevant information. But once you re-index memories from this point, it's also forgetting where you have been for holiday in the first year of life. Because this new locus does not have these memories, because they were not. And
it doesn't, some people do
there
claim to remember.
But, yes.
But you have subconscious memories from your childhood.
Yeah, the data is stored there, right? It's just not integrated under this persona. So it's difficulty to access these memories. But in the right context, when you trigger these memories using smells or many other things or direct cortical stimulation and so on, you can show that they're still there.
And then could you just elaborate briefly on how essential this self-awareness or self-reflectivity is for consciousness? Because I know that's a subject of debate, you know, how it, if it's an essential component or not. A lot of people think there's the pure conscious state that has no, or pure conscious event that has no self-reflection.
It has no personal self. But imagine that you are dreaming at night and you don't remember that you are a person or what your name is or what city you live in or what you look like. There might not even be a perspectivity on the scene that you experience, but there is the notion that experience is taking place and you notice that you're noticing, right? Without there being a distinct you necessarily. So I think this reflexive attention is essential for what we mean by consciousness. And I don't mean this in a functional sense, but in an indexical sense, when we talk
right
about what we mean by consciousness, we mean this reflexive perception in
right
which something notices that something is being noticed. But the personal self and so on is just a particular content of that.
But you could have qualia without just pure kind, but qualia
yes
without.
If you take qualia to be basically its contents that you reflect on.
Right.
I wanted to extend something on the memory aspect. Because, you know, even my own personal experiences, there are just these times that seemingly some random memory from, you know, 15 years ago, which is crazy to say because I'm 22, but 15 years ago, and I'll just remember it like so vividly, comes seemingly out of nowhere, out of thin air, right? And I wonder if that's kind of a byproduct of the idea that we can't hold all that much information in our minds simultaneously. Because, you know, in theory, if you had something that was just storing this all simultaneously at once, you wouldn't have to go and reach into something else or something else would pull through. Right? I mean, have you ever actually tried to keep all of these things in your head simultaneously while you're doing a test or playing tennis or doing something you can't? There's this kind of threshold you reach in your mind, like you're stretching it and then you can't stretch it any further. So I wonder if long-term memory in these subconscious memories are almost a redundancy to working memory because we can't keep it all in our mind at once. And that's probably just part of being a local observer of things because things in the past may not be directly relevant to what's going on right now.
Yeah, I noticed that children are typically completely in the scene in which they currently are and have difficulty to imagine what the next scene is going to be. So you basically know that there are doors outside of this scene, but you do not really make plans for that next scene that you're going to be in. And then over time, we learn how to predict what the next scene is, and we make plans over multiple scenes. I have the suspicion that cats have a special difficulty with this. Right? When the cat wants to leave the room, the cat makes a plan for this and goes to the door and signals to you that the door should be open, but then you open the door. And the scene changes so much that the cat is basically recomputing the scene from scratch. Right? The room with the door open is such a different room now that the cat needs to completely re-deliberate what it actually wants in this new scene. And this leads to the cat considering from scratch whether it wants to leave the door. I don't know whether that's actually the case, but it's a tempting theory that basically the cat is storing its goals below the scene graph node rather than above. And a similar thing is happening in small children. If a child throws a tantrum, very often you can just pick it up, put it in the next room, and it will have forgotten what the tantrum was about because the scene is so new that it's unable to keep the goal stable. And so at some point, we learn how to construct a meta scene that is more abstract, in which you kept the goal stable, and the particular scene that you currently experience and are operating in is below this more general node. But the experiential scene is this local perceptual space. It's a game engine that is basically building this map, in which you see all these objects right now in the room and in which you currently operate. And everything else is somewhat offline and separate from this map. And you store many, many cues in your long-term memory that allow you to construct and reconstruct all sorts of maps and interact with them. And these are the memories that you instantiate then in your working memory context. But the working memory context is quite limited. But it's basically the scene graph of a game engine that is maintaining a bunch of objects. And I suspect it's all self-organizing controller. So you basically have the scene controller at the top that is keeping the existence of the scene stable and instantiates the space in which objects are. When a person enters the room, we are instantiating a person controller that keeps that person stable for as long as it's perceptually validated and then animates that person and it attributes states to it with lots and lots of sub-controllers. So in some sense, in a hierarchical structure that is somewhat analogous to when you are looking at a game engine.
Yeah, and that's why I even extending on to that about just the way like our bodies react to the modern environment. Like if you've noticed, when we're creating gyms or treadmills or changing things about our diet or wearing blue light blocking glasses, we're kind of falling back on our evolutionary past. We're expressing it in different ways, but we're still kind of a slave to that in a way, right? So the interesting thing is that what you're almost doing is you're kind of directly relying on things in the environment, in the ecosystem to define what you are, to set that boundary. That's why things like exercise seem to be good for us, or certain dietary habits are good for us, or when we have to sleep a certain way or react a certain way to things. If you have both of those metrics moving, the agent and the ecosystem, then there's nothing for it to really tie onto. And that's what happens when we've made this radical change in our civilization in the last couple of hundred years. And now our bodies have no way to interpret that as a language because it's trying to find whatever is the closest thing to what it's familiar with, and it doesn't really know how to interpret this new information. So one of the things that Mike does in terms of how that's applicable to like longevity and aging research is how do you actually cognitively train an agent, an organism, right, to actually interpret this newer environment. And that could be why we see these types of extremophiles out there these crazy, unique, regenerative capabilities.
Because it's more the other way around. If you want to have a complex organism that is more interesting than the blobs that Mike Levin studies that are somewhat immortal, you basically adapt by generational change.
Yep.
And if the environment is changing faster, you need to increase the frequency of generational change, which means you decrease the lifespan. The reason why we become senescent is not so much just because our bodies wear out, they're tuned to wear out at a certain rate. And this rate is, I think, synchronized with generational change. We basically fall apart at the time where we would outcompete our grandchildren for food. We're not supposed to outcompete our grandchildren for food because they are them in two generations from now. Right? And this is the way in which we are interfacing. We have this overlap over the generations so we can download our intellects on the next generation and not everything is lost. But the way in which we adapt to changing environments is child mortality. And it's probably as much as an issue that we change our world so fast, the same way that we reduce child mortality because it, reduces our ability to adapt. Normally, you had 9 children, 2 of them were good,
yeah,
and carried you into the next generation. And now we have 1.3 children, of which the same ratio is good. And I'm not advocating for more child mortality, but for the fact that this explains a lot of our difficulties of adapting to a changing environment. There are regions in Africa where people are very resistant to DDT because they used enormous amounts of toxic chemicals in their agriculture that were outlawed here because they killed too many people, but they led to evolutionary adaptation. And we are probably able to adapt to all the hormones or hormone equivalent endocrine disruptors in our food supply that we introduced in the last 50 years, if we wait for future generations, if we have meaningful adaptation, messy mutation and selection, but everybody loves mutation, everybody hates selection.
Yeah.
And there's no easy way around this.
There isn't.
At least not until we are able to edit our genes and our organisms in the way in which we want.
And that's the interesting thing about death, because you're kind of looking at that transition between an iteration from the, you know, version 1 to version 2. And I think that one of our biggest issues with death isn't necessarily death itself, but I think it's more about how do we transfer over that information to the next generation. So, I mean, if you think about what we've kind of done, is you have these shorter living organisms that are faster reproducing, whatever, and then you have things like humans or whales or whatever that are larger, slower metabolism, usually live a bit longer, right? Now, I wonder if there's a way to kind of get the best of both worlds and have, you can have a faster iterating organism that always communicates, and that could be through culture, and you're kind of decentralizing your the memory of that culture and things around you. Like, for example, like that's kind of what we do. That's why we have textbooks, we have history, so that we're carrying on things from previous iterations to the following one. It's kind of remaining.
No, but you will see all this in evolution. And
yeah,
it could be that we are just not a very long game species, a very,
yeah,
sustainable species. All our cousin species have gone extinct already. And it might just be a very exciting, short-lived experiment in nature. But that's also part of how evolution works. Evolution does not trend towards stable equilibria. It trends towards exciting dynamics, of which some are just transitional things. Are there any other questions, other topics?
Yeah. I just wanted to get back a little bit to the second order perceptions that you were,
mm-hmm,
talking about with defining consciousness and the observer, essentially. I'm just trying to think of what would be a good threshold to actually state whether something does have second order perception when we ourselves can really only determine it in ourselves. Like, we're working with a totally different model. Like, if we take some sort of alien species or even something on this planet, when we're working with our own language model to function off of, how can we actually perceive that they have second perception?
Very interesting question. So there's a practical sense in which you can develop empathy with other people. So if you build a feedback loop into the mind of another person that is bidirectional, you can often notice that this other person is aware of their own awareness, and of course, and you can even do this with a cat, right? It's much more difficult with an AI that is asynchronous to you. And it's especially difficult with, for instance, LLMs. The question whether an LLM is conscious is, I think, much more complicated than most people make it out to be. I know a bunch of people at OpenAI who think that for our practical purposes, they do develop reflexive awareness. And there's this question, do they understand anything? Of course, if you take a system, you ask it, take this string and arrange all the characters in the opposite order, and it does that, it means that understood what you ask it to, because it maps to the same function as you would. And it's unreasonable to say that this is just a simulation of understanding, because it's actually performing that thing what you're looking for. And when you ask that thing to infer your mental states, it's also able to infer your mental states from the communication context, because it has learned all these regularities by analyzing enormous amounts of human text. And if you ask it to simulate a persona that has these mental states and so on, it's able to do this in the same way as somebody writing a novel is able to create the story about a person that has all those mental states and has consistent thoughts that are being following from each other, that's able to do this with much higher resolution and detail than human novelist could. Right, so the LLM itself is probably not conscious in the same way as our brain is not conscious. But the person that is being simulated by our brain is conscious, right? Experiences itself as conscious, is a virtual entity. And is the virtual entity that is created by the LLM less conscious, more simulated than the one that is in our own brain? It's a very interesting question. And I think it's a really complicated one. I don't think that it serves all the same functions. It's mostly a simulacrum that produces the same observables, of course. And the function that it produces in the system is more or less incidental, whereas the function in our own mind might be to create coherence. The transformer doesn't need to do this because it is working on a deterministic substrate. So the attention model of the transformer, I think, is not exactly the same type of attention, or very similar to the type of attention that exists in our own mind. There is something else going on there.
Can I ask a question about collective consciousness? Yes. So I read some psychological things about saying that people in intimate relationship, they feel they are becoming a one person instead of two persons. So I'm just wondering, you said consciousness can rise in the process of organizing things inside of brain, but how about between brains?
Yes. So basically, when you are vibing very strong with another person, it means you're building feedback loops in the other mind. And these feedback loops do not rely on the direct connection between cells that need to be directly adjacent so they can exchange chemicals, but it can also work by integrating information from your environment. And if this happens with sufficient bandwidth, with sufficient rate, you're basically able to synchronize mental states. And this also allows you, because you now get some more capacity to have mental states that you couldn't have alone. And so consciousness is not a thing that manifests in the mind. It is a function that is being implemented in the interaction patterns of the cells. And if that function can synchronize itself across more organisms in this sense, you could say that you could have something like a shared consciousness. Whether it's functionally the same as the consciousness in your own mind is something that you can experimentally discern. I find it very interesting to look at the phenomenon of a seance. A seance happens when you get a bunch of people into a dimly lit room and get them into a trance. And they touch each other and they touch a VR board. And then they ask questions to this VR board, which is basically just moved by subconscious movements of their hands collectively to spell out letters on this board. And I think what's happening in this state is that the minds of these people produce an LLM together. They basically get entangled. You prompt this LLM with the question and it's giving answers, and it's not connected to anyone's perception. So it's not actually representing reality as it is. Instead, it's going to dream things that cannot be invalidated based on information that is available to all these minds individually that are now connected to these feedback loops. And it's an interesting phenomenon that human minds are able to produce such a phenomenon. You don't need to assume that physics is wrong in any way to explain such a phenomenon. It's an interpsychological phenomenon, but we don't have a lot of interpsychological science so far. And so I think there is a lot of opportunity for doing very hard testable research on basically shared mental states and how they lead to phenomena across people.
Yeah, when talking about crossing people, the time delay become much higher than the neural communication inside of the brain. So is it possible that this kind of integrated feeling is not happening across people, but instead people are simulating others? So each one has their own integrated reality.
The question is at some point, what is the difference as long as these realities are synchronized?
Because the time delay is high. So
but the time delay in your cortex is also high. So basically, if you want to send a signal through your entire neocortex, it's like 300 milliseconds. Your brain is roughly working at the speed of sound. And so your brain is able to deal with all those delays. And it does this by creating periodic processes. The reason why you see these brain waves, a wave is basically a periodic process. The It's a circle extended in time. Basically means that a bunch of loops that are repeating themselves and that are handing off results to each other. And if you can build such periodic loops across organisms, you're able to deal with those delays. And the reason why you're able to represent things as simultaneous, despite the information transfer being so long, is you can assume that the contents of the loops changes only very slowly. Right? So you're perceiving certain things and you are updating this in a loop that is updating itself shorter and shorter intervals than the other parts of your brain that rely on that information to be current. But because the loop only changes slowly, you just need to be at the same phase to make sure that you are roughly on the same page. And in those regions where it doesn't happen, you build a local predictor. And this local predictor is going to model what the state of that distant loop is going to be. So you have that information locally available. And you see this in your nervous system, for instance, when you're walking the stairs in a dark basement and you miss the last stair suddenly. It's a very weird movement. And it happens because you are out of sync. You're simulating what it looks like when your foot moves. But because the information from your foot going to your brain is too slow, you're out of sync. You're basically one period out of sync with the movement of that foot. And because you don't have visual input in the dark, you cannot accommodate the fact that the stair is stopping and you suddenly notice this mismatch. And such a thing is, in principle, also possible across minds. So as long as you're fine with the fact that it takes time for you to synchronize, you can still build bidirectional synchronization.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, so if the time delay, so does the time delay really matter? Because the synchronization might not happen at all frequencies.
As long as the synchronization is still possible. It seems that the duration of a moment in the brain is how long can two events be apart for us to still recognize them as one thing is limited to an interval of about 3 seconds or so. But that's a pretty long interval. And there's also the shortest interval, how far can two events to be separate, need to be separate in time to perceive them as separate. And this is the realm in which the synchronization of events can happen. But I suspect this realm is basically whatever you can keep stable in the neurons that you're using.
This is interesting. Thank you.
Do you think that brains or other beings can stay synchronized when they're not in close proximity anymore? Or do you need close proximity for the synchronization to happen? For example, I know you talked about telepathy. I find it very interesting that maybe the synchronization keeps on going if you are close to someone.
I noticed some weird phenomena when an accident happens to me or so. My wife sometimes notices, and over longer distances. And we can explain this by selective memories. Maybe she often has experiences like this, but she will only remember in those instances where it's correlated to something. But I find a lot of people have difficulty to explain telepathy away. So regardless of whether we believe in those phenomena or not, I suspect that if we allow for the existence of something like a biological internet, it's probably not going to end at the boundary of a single ecosystem, because there have been ecosystems throughout the planet for a very long time. And so maybe there is something like a global organismic internet that doesn't work at the frequency of our nervous system, but that works across the cells in our organism. And maybe you can integrate information over the cells of your organism. It's probably not going to be high bandwidth communication. But if you're fine with receiving only a few bits every now and then over a long distance, I don't think it's physiologically implausible that your body could act like an antenna. I don't know the conditions of that under which this would be and how you would measure it. But I don't think that you would need to leave the boundaries of known physics to allow that organisms are sophisticated enough to also transmit information that is relevant over longer distances, outside of the senses that are accessible to your nervous system.
I feel like you can do it almost like it's a fine-tuning or predictive algorithm that you've developed for that specific individual. Like you've spent a lot of time with them. You know how they're going to act in a lot of variable interactions. Even if it might seem like it was like an accident out of the blue, there's some predictability to everything in life. And perhaps, yes, we're picking these things out with bias, but there is something to be said about like you better understand this person. So you're going to think like, oh, did they just get injured? Or, oh, did they just consume a substance? Like something like that.
Yeah, but you might not know this. So it is tempting to think it could be some kind of super determinism that allows you to simulate what the person is going to do at some point.
Mm-hmm.
But what the person is going to do does not just depend on that person. Whether this person gets into a traffic accident largely depends on other drivers that you don't know and probably don't have a connection to.
Yeah.
And so it's difficult to explain it all this way, but we also know that people do edit their memories, and especially when they're motivated to do so, and it's not a conscious thing. So it's, I think, correct to be skeptical about this and read evidence very carefully. But it's not necessary to dismiss all this evidence, because it is conceivable that it's possible, right?
Yeah.
What you do notice is that when you study people at Burning Man that do trips, you notice this phenomenon of contact high, which basically means people change their state based on the state of their environment. It's not just that people get in a different mood if people are sitting next to them, but they can even start to trip when people next to them are tripping. And it's a very interesting phenomenon that basically people have this physical resonance in their substrates that can be so strong that their mental representations start to resonate and go out of whack in the same way. And if you also notice this with, say, mothers and babies, I have sequences of pictures of my wife and a baby looking exactly in the same direction, having the same facial expressions without looking at each other over a longer period of time. It's quite interesting, and it's basically tempting to think what happens while she holds that baby is that they physically resonate so much that their mental states interact.
And that baby did also come from her, like for a while their identities were entangled.
Yes,
there's
but their nervous systems
like
are no longer physically connected, right? So they're not looking at each other.
Yeah.
So they're basically integrating information over each other in such a way that their mental states get synchronized to a large degree. And this is also what mothers very often report, that they basically feel what the baby is feeling. And now the question is, how much can you take them apart without that phenomenon completely breaking down? And so the idea here would be that if you have people in the same room without physically touching each other, it's still possible for them to have that degree of a certain degree of synchronization, so you can feel the emotions of other people in the room without even looking at them. And it could also work outside of the room, as long as there is enough information crossing physically between the bodies of these people in such a way that it eventually can be interpreted.
There were siblings that have never met each other, but they named their dog the same.
This is another interesting phenomenon, but this suggests that there is a lot more determinism in the structure of the phenotype based on genetic heritage. I think that's, it's probably a sum of environment and individual. So basically, to name, give the dog the same name, they also need to grow up in the same culture.
Yeah.
But even given the same culture, they're seeking out the same stimuli.
Yeah.
The point that I would add to that is, when you have a shared ecosystem, that's essentially a shared language. You're sharing the same alphabet and grammar. You're sharing, you know, what we're all doing right now, right? For example, is there are these noises coming out of our mouths. Okay, right. These noises don't necessarily have an inherent meaning. We have a shared hallucination, a shared agreement that this means this.
Yeah, that's
this
clear. What
that.
Is your question?
No, my question to that point is that is, would you agree that you can very much, if you have people at different points in space and time, have enough similarity in their timeline of things that they do, that they could essentially be synchronized? They're not physically linked to each other with a rope, but they're actually, you know, abstractly doing the same thing because there's enough similarities. That's why if you spend enough time with somebody adding to their points, you start to think like each other, right? You're sharing an abstracted structure together in the way that you communicate things and think about things. You do that long enough, and then you get these things called cultures, where everybody in this clique, when you create a category or a group, correct, you're creating a shared perception of reality in front of you that's by nature separate from some other perception of reality to another group.
Yeah,
now, how do you get those
conceptual categories here?
How do you get those groups A and B to be synchronized even though they're different?
I think a culture does not mean that people think the same thing. So you could say they do, but then it's a different thing from people naming their dog the same, or people having the same emotion at the same time despite doing different things and being in separate rooms. Right? These are different phenomena, and I think it makes sense to treat them as separate phenomena and describe them with the separate terminology. Because a culture can exist with very different individuals that don't agree in their perception of the world, but they are complementary in some way and can meaningfully interface with each other, interact with each other. And it's not the same thing as thinking the same.
So earlier you were talking about your experience with kind of like the would you characterize that as like going back to earlier when you characterized like the 6 plus the 0 level of consciousness? Would you characterize that as like another level of that? And if so, why does it not naturally occur for most people and it requires training? Like the Buddhist.
Typically, you only need attention for the things that don't work. And the parts of your mind that don't work don't attract your attention, don't attract your attention. So the reason why most interesting people had interesting childhoods is because you don't get attention in things that always work for you. You don't question your own personality, you don't question your interactions with the environment, if they work. And if your instincts constantly fail you, you might be forced to reconsider the entire architecture of reality. In some sense, that's my own story, and I guess the story of many scientists, that I'm born with worse priors than most people. I'm basically born much more stupid than the average person. And as a result, I needed to put attention on building a model of reality that worked for me. Whereas other people don't have that need. I noticed this when I gave a TEDx talk, and MIT asked me to prepare this with the local Toastmasters group, with normal, real people instead of crazy MIT students that I normally had in my class. And they gave me very different feedback than the MIT students would have given me. The first one was, you need to speak more slowly. You need to reduce the rate of ideas by a factor of about at least 30. Second, you need to explain why this is, what this is good for. Why would you need to understand consciousness? Does this help you to cure cancer or solve depression? Right, and that is a very interesting thing. Most people don't have that issue. There is no need to solve consciousness because it works, right? But why would you need to figure out what that is? And it's only when you feel, oh my God, I'm born into a monkey, and in this kind of universe, and you might disagree with your government, but I find myself disagreeing with the entire universe. What's going on here? Why am I uploaded into a monkey? How does this even work? Right, so you basically need to get attention on something that's a mismatch between how things are and how things should be, and all your attention arises over disagreements with how the universe works.
So attention is all you need.
That works. Yeah, so the thing that currently interests me most is how can we make progress on understanding these questions more productively? And an issue that I found while I was working in academia, especially while I was in Germany, was that students were super interested in all this stuff. And I was studying mostly AI, but also all the other subjects I was interested in. And then students asked me, where can we actually have actual AI lectures? Because we got lectures in machine learning or case-based reasoning, but not in artificial intelligence. And so I realized, oh, we need to reread Society of Mind and Piaget and cognitive architectures and build our own curriculum. And most of that was stuff that was more or less dormant. There were relatively few people within the field of AI that were still working on those questions. And it was not because these questions are not interesting, but because most people agreed that you will not be able to resolve them in the space of a grant proposal. And so when I proposed working on topics like understanding agency and a multi-agent paradigm and so on, it was always the question, what is the thing that you can answer within the time frame of 1.5 or maybe 3 years? Because otherwise that's not fundable. And the same thing is that tenure positions are built around series of such projects. And so I realized that all the professorships that were open to me that I was offered was things like a semantic map or cognitive robotics and so on. And I felt semantic map is going to go away. Why would you want to annotate semantics with XML? It's going to be a non-issue in a few years from now. right? And it was, but at the time, because it was a fashionable topic, he could get a job doing this. And I guess there's still professors working on this stuff because they got a job for this. And at the same time, many of the topics that we are interested in, that got us into science, are not being worked on. And how can we create spaces and methodologies to do paradigmatic work in this region? And I suspect if you want to work on consciousness, we currently cannot really do it in neuroscience. Most neuroscience is actually not curious about how this works. And because they don't have a methodology to address it, it's not even a very scientific notion for them. And ditto in psychology. That's a very big issue to me, because it is a question that I think we can make progress on and that we have to work on. But how would we actually do this? How can we develop a methodology and terminology and so on, and a discipline to actually meaningfully work on it? And so at the moment, I suspect that we need to create some institution similar to Santa Fe Institute for Complexity Science for studying consciousness in a computational paradigm that is integrating over neuroscience and psychology and AI and philosophy, and is taking ideas from all these fields, but is not committing to any of the existing methodologies because they're all not productive for studying it. And I guess Mike's institute is also in a similar situation in many ways, that is trying to do things that normally should be done by neuroscientists or biologists, but are not.
Yeah, Eric Hoyle has a, who used to be here at Tufts, he has a really good essay on this. It's called Neuroscientist Pre-Paradigmatic Consciousness is Why. Yeah. So,
but I suspect that
what
happens
is everybody started going into
neuroscience is already post-paradigmatic. It doesn't care about a paradigm anymore. It's just methodological.
Right, exactly. That's what he talks about. Yeah,
yeah.
It's focused on.
But I think this is adding to your point about some kind of institute or structure or framework that lets you kind of draw from these different fields together under a shared language in that case. Right? I mean, maybe you could say a shared language is natural language or mathematics or whatever, but how do you get people, neuroscience and psychology and physics and biochemistry and all these different fields to come together and collaborate in an effective way? I think Santa Fe has done a pretty reasonable job of that with complexity. But I think there is more to be done. And I think we have to also have a structure that takes into consideration the nature of having a different perspective. Because let me ask you this, do you feel like when you start to seek agreement with things, you're already kind of shooting yourself in the foot?
I don't understand that question.
if I'm seeking to agree with something, that's basically saying I'm trying to target something to fit into this puzzle. Maybe that puzzle is incorrect and that's been interpreted differently and you should be going another route. But because you're kind of getting this tunnel vision of, oh, I have to solve it this way and only this way, or this is a problem, maybe you have to step back, refresh your mind a little bit, reinterpret that and say, maybe this isn't a puzzle piece, but this is actually a Rubik's Cube or something else.
Have you ever
sense?
Noticed when we look at evil super scientists in movies that they're actually not scientists, but they are engineers?
Yeah.
But there is usually no control group, there is no peer-reviewed study. Instead, there is somebody who tries to get something to work. And I suspect that in the time when science was most productive in this modernist era, which ended roughly in the 1970s and so on, most scientists in a way were engineers that tried to get things to work. And it's also what I found to be a very productive stance in computer science, that when you want to understand like sorting, you can make theories about sorting, but eventually you need to write testable algorithms. And what you discover is very often you think you found the optimum, but you did not. And you often need to do experiments in this way. And the experiment is usually not about how can I apply my known sorting algorithm in many, many ways and pretend it's the best one. But it's basically, it always works by, I think this is a pretty good idea, please everybody shoot it down.
Yeah.
And this is how you make progress. So it's not trying to agree, it's the way to disagree. And the thing that's most valuable in science is not so much the answer, it's this uncertainty. Discovering new uncertainty is super valuable, because finding answers to questions is often much, much easier. Right? There are methods for this, or you can develop them, it's somewhat straightforward. But finding productive questions that you can actually meaningfully answer and that give you useful insights that you can then apply to build a better model of reality that lets you act better on it, that lets you understand deeper what you want to know. That, I think, is the job. that you have to do with your developing paradigms.
What do you think is the main driver about why people don't like to combine fields together?
It has to do with career considerations. It seems that the PhD is designed as a great filter. Some of people who manage to get through the PhD and enter tenured positions feel that thinking is frivolous. It's just a self-gratifying masturbatory activity that you should not actually engage in. Instead, you should have learned that your job is about applying methods. And so you learn how to do this, and the questions are limited to the things for which you already have good methods, because this is what makes you productive, which increases your impact factor, which allows you to publish in the existing communities, in existing journals, on the existing topics that are reviewed by your existing peers. And so it's a normal dynamic that can only be broken if something comes in from the outside and says, you need to understand that academia is the garden. And sometimes you need to uproot a region of the garden and plant something new. And if you just let the garden grow by itself, then it's going to replicate what's already there.
This is just look into the field of metascience, because it's really a systemic issue with how science is funded and the short-term nature of grants, and the program managers overseeing those grants are coming through the same system where they're developing myopic short-term research. So this is why I think meta science is really important. And what was I just gonna say?
It's also important that somebody actually cares. And if you look at the system right now, it does not seem that there are many adults left at the top. Nobody really seems to care about keeping the civilization afloat and keeping it on course in an organized way. And so there is nobody there who can tell the universities, now you need to change in a way that makes you productive again and make some progress on those questions.
I remember what I was going to say. One solution is funding people, not grants. Mm-hmm. So just funding really brilliant people, giving them some leeway for several years, say, or funding institutions or groups. There are many good ideas on how to improve science. It's just reforming any system is hard.
Yes. So I suspect that now we mostly identify no longer as individuals who developed ideas or developed theories or intellects that you interact with, but you are part of teams, of large groups that apply certain methods, certain paradigms, and so on. And this, the individual becomes exchangeable in this whole thing. And in this perspective, it's much harder to make progress on new paradigms. It's fascinating that when Kuhn came up with this notion of normal science and so on, that normal science didn't exist yet. You see next door, somebody like Minsky was creating AI, and Chomsky was creating linguistics, and everything was still paradigmatic and pre-paradigmatic. And this idea of normal science was also a new paradigm. It's an interesting question to which degree there was a self-fulfilling prophecy or just a very prescient anticipation of what was going to happen.
It does seem like the things have become more locked in. The interval between paradigm shifts is growing. Some people think that's due to less low-hanging fruit, but...
Yes. I remember studying psychology as an undergrad and seeing that the way in which they did statistics would not possibly work. Like this idea, we remove all the outliers and we repeat the experiment for as often as we need until we get a good p-value. And the p-value is that thing that decides that it's good. And you will always find what you predict in your study, otherwise you cannot publish it. And then there comes this famous replication crisis. And the outcome of the replication crisis, somebody describes it as, you learn that there was an airplane crash and 50,000 of your loved ones have died in this airplane crash. And the depressing thing is that nobody bothers to even ID them. Nobody cares which ones don't replicate and which parts are now invalid, because nothing depends on anything. It's entirely only an employment program, apparently.
Yes.
Yeah, so I don't know really what to do about this. And it's not that science before that was ideal and non-defective, right? It's an evolving enterprise, and there's always stuff going to be decaying, and there's also probably stuff going to innovate and happen in new ways. And I think we are now in a very happy circumstance, because AI seems to be working surprisingly well. we have a deficit of understanding what it does and what it does to us. And the present level of discourse is mostly Emily Bender and the New York Times versus Sam Altman's blog, which is abysmal if this is the last stand of Western intellectualism against the machines and the statistical models, right? This is not the level at which it should be. And I think optimistically, this should be a wake-up call for us to reinvent a vigorous science and philosophy that is able to deal with these new challenges. Yeah, so I suspect what we should probably be doing is to build an interdisciplinary network that is working not just across the US, but starting maybe here and in the Bay Area, and is connecting a lot of places to basically get us to reinvent the sciences of the mind.
Amen.
Okay, thank you very much for your attention. I enjoyed it very much.